السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين حضرت مسیح موعود علیہ الصلوۃ والسلام ایک جگہ فرماتے ہیں
The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has said in one place that I have been sent so that the time of truth and faith can come back once again. And in order for taqwa, righteousness and the fear of Allah to be established within the hearts. An Ahmadi who claims to have entered into the allegiance or the fold of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. He needs to keep these words of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, that he stated in view at every single moment. He should seriously reflect on his words and he must strive to mold his life in accordance with these words. It is only when an Ahmadi does this that he will be doing justice to the requirements and the obligations of the Bayt, that is the Pledge of Allegiance. Otherwise, an Ahmadi will merely be making a verbal assertion that he is an Ahmadi. That truth and faith that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, desired to bring and for which Allah the Almighty sent him. Through which taqwa develops in the heart. This is not something new. This is evident from the statement of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, that so that the time of truth and faith comes back once again. In other words, the time of taqwa, truth and faith were established in some preceding era, but now they are nowhere to be seen. And to re-establish all of this was the mission of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. As we are all aware, that era of truth, faith and taqwa, it reached its pinnacle and time of greatest glory and splendor when God Almighty sent our Master, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, to the world, thereby completing and perfecting the Shariat. And Allah the Almighty said that Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenukum Wa Atmamtu Alaykum Ni'mati Wa Raditu Lakum Al-Islama Deena, that this day I have perfected your religion for your benefit and completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as a religion. So it was when God Almighty made this announcement, that was a time of truth, faith and taqwa, and when it was all firmly established. Ahmadis hold not even the slightest doubt regarding the reality of this. Neither do they ever perceive that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, brought anything new. Nor can any Ahmadi ever hold such a notion. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, was destined to come only to re-establish that truth, faith and taqwa in the world in accordance with the prophecies of the Holy Quran and the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has come to re-establish what the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had established, and which the Muslims were deprived of as a result of their bad deeds and misfortune. So therefore, when we Ahmadis state that we have believed in the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, then we would also need to determine that have we actually made efforts to develop that very faith in ourselves which the Holy Quran has taught us to generate, and that faith which the companions instilled within themselves? Have we previously striven, or are we currently striving to embed that truth within us? The truth which masses of believers at the time of the Holy Prophet ﷺ took on, thereby bringing about a revolution within themselves. Have we striven to form that taqwa, righteousness and fear of Allah in our hearts, the like of which we read and hear about in the lives of the companions of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him? The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in his time and in his own life, brought about this revolution within the lives of his companions. I mention the details of this from time to time whenever I relate the incidents and accounts of the lives of the companions of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. With regard to this statement written by the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, that I have been sent so that the time of truth and faith be re-established, and in order for taqwa, righteousness and the fear of Allah to be inculcated within the hearts. A few lines after this, the promised Messiah alayhi salam states, so this is the real purpose of my advent. In other words, this is the basis and object for the coming of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, and the true purport of his existence. Therefore, when the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in one place addresses his believers and says, oh, the green and fresh branches of my tree. So these works the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has referred to are the tasks that one should perform so that he can become part of these green and fresh branches of his tree. Because the promised Messiah alayhi salam has declared this to be the most fundamental aspect of his advent. It is impossible that a flourishing and luscious tree full of delicious fruit starts bearing poisonous fruits, or that dry branches remain a part of such a tree. The owner of a tree never allows dry branches to remain on it. Rather, he would cut such dry branches and separate them from the tree. Therefore, this is something of great concern and fear. We should bear this in mind at all times, that after taking the bet, the pledge of allegiance, what are our responsibilities? Those who enter the Jamaat anew, when I read the letters or hear the accounts of these new converts, then it strengthens our faith. However, there are so many amongst us whose ancestors were Ahmadis. When it comes to light, at times that weaknesses are developing in their descendants, then it causes extreme pain and anguish. that in accordance with the desire of the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, they are not inclined in a way that they should be towards implementing the teachings of Islam. Being a born Ahmadi often leads to slackness in some. Therefore, every single one of us must examine our hearts. We need to scrutinize our own hearts and analyze that are we being pushed towards slackness, such slackness that God forbid, could ever lead us to a point of no return. Or we need to analyze that are we only those who are Ahmadis by name? The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in his guidance and in various of his writings, has drawn attention towards this. That the true spirit of Ahmadiyyat can only maintain and be established when we continuously assess our own conditions and when there is no contradiction between our words and deeds. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, desired to see a clear distinction between us and others. In one place he states, I have said repeatedly and on numerous occasions that in their apparent names, our Jamaat and other Muslims are alike. You are also Muslims, and they too call themselves Muslims. You profess the Muslim creed, and so do they. You claim to follow the Holy Quran, and they also claim to adhere to the Holy Quran. In short, in terms of claims, you are both equal. However, Allah is not satisfied with mere claims alone, until it is accompanied and supported with a reality and practicality, and until in support of the claim there is not practical evidence and a self-reformation to accompany it. This is why often Hazur says that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam says there should be a practical change in support of the claim and evidence for this. That is, the practical transformation should be clearly demonstrated and this should be evident and this will be proof of this change. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam says that this is why often I am utterly shocked out of this grief. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states that Allah is not satisfied with mere claims alone until it is supported with real testimony, and until there is not support for the claim with practical reformation, practical evidence and reformation of the heart. This is why I am often utterly shocked out of this grief. Hazur says, thus the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, he desires practical evidence from us. So if we analyze our own condition, we could account for ourselves in a much better way. Sometimes when others admonish us, it irritates us. Or at times, by admonishing others, it leads to a burgeoning ego. However, the stipulation that has been placed here is that if you want to assess yourselves, you must always keep in mind that Allah the Almighty is watching me at every single moment, and that I have made a pledge of allegiance which I am bound by, and which to abide by is my obligation. If a person does this, then he will be able to account for himself in a much better way. An Ahmadi, however weak he may be, he still has some aspects of righteousness within him. When this righteousness begins to sprout, then it flourishes from within him. Therefore, every single person needs to keep this piety alive with the water of his pious deeds. He needs to freshen this. He needs to realize a deep concern and anguish of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, he who appreciates this. His condition transformed from that of a dry branch into a flourishing and green branch. Numerous people write letters to me and they are filled with a burning desire that pious reformation comes within us that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam desired to see inculcated within them. So whoever tries to bring about this realization and ask for Allah's succor and help, then Allah, who is more loving and compassionate to His people than a mother, He runs to a person who comes towards Him and He embraces him. Such people's lives are entirely reformed. Therefore, Allah the Almighty has given us a golden opportunity to augment and reform our life in this world and the next. If we do not properly derive benefit from this, then it will be our own great misfortune. The shock and deep anguish expressed by the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, it was at that time when there were those companions of his who were directly living amongst him and benefiting from his guidance. When we read and hear about the lofty examples, we become envious with regard to the revolutions that they brought within their own lives. Despite this, look at the grief and pain of the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him. Look at the level of his taqwa, his righteousness and fear of Allah, which he expected and desired his followers to reach, that even at that time, he stayed seeing the condition of just a few, that I am utterly shocked out of this grief. So look how much our condition of weakness causes shock. Although the Promised Messiah alayhi salam is not physically present amongst us in the same way, however, Allah the Almighty can manifest our state to Him. That what the condition is of which companion's descendants and the progeny of His dear ones and His holy people. Those people at the time of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam saved themselves from an impure environment and for the sake of attaining Allah's pleasure left their whole lives and worlds and attached themselves to the mantle of the Messiah, and they spent their entire lives adhering to the pledge that they would always give precedence to their faith over the world. The religious condition of some of these descendants and children has weakened, and some are not concerned at all about this. Therefore, in order to reform ourselves and safeguard our own condition, we need to look into the lives of the companions with this intention that there should be a purpose before us that we strive to fulfill. We should reflect on the various aspects of their life. We need to find out the reason why they took the bet, the Pledge of Allegiance. It is only then when we will be moving towards a destination and a proper objective, and we will be those who fulfill their wishes and their desires. A few days pass when the son of a very holy person, Abdul Mughni Khan Sahib, his son was telling me about him, that Modvi Sahib has studied BSc in chemistry from Aligarh University. In those days, there were normally few Muslims studying science. So the Vice Chancellor said that this is a good subject that you have taken and you have achieved a distinction. And so we offer you a job in the university and you would be able to continue your studies further. His father had obtained a recommendation from an English friend. At that time, the British government ruled India. So he had also offered him a good job. Then that person received the advice that he was intelligent, so that by giving the exam in the Indian Civil Service, he would be able to join it. Khan Sahib in those days was in Qadian. It was the era of Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih II, may Allah be pleased with him. He informed him of the details of what had passed and said, "Hazur, I do not want any part of materialism or worldly pursuits. I could stay in Qadian, and even if I received work to sweep the streets and alleys of Qadian, I would give it preference over these high job offers." So there were such holy and noble people at the time as well, who later received the beneficence and blessings from the companions as well. So after this, Khan Sahib was made a science teacher in the school, after which he was appointed Nazir Baitul Mal. Perhaps he was the very first Nazir Baitul Mal. Anyhow, the holy people of old, and in particular the companions of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, they were those who excelled others in righteousness and piety. However, when the condition of a few of them was weak, and the promised Messiah alayhi salam observed this weakness, he says, "It utterly shocks me to the heart." Hazur says, "So therefore there is a dire need for us to examine our own conditions, and if we realize who we are the descendants of, and after accepting Ahmadiyyat, what pious reformations did these holy and saintly people bring about within themselves? So if we deeply reflect on this, and if we pledge that we will not discredit the name of our saints of the past, then this means of reformation will raise our level of taqwa in a most excellent manner. And it will prompt and attract us towards carrying out righteous deeds. And this is the sign of living nations, that they do not allow the values and traditions of the people of old to die away. They continue to increase their rank and status. New converts also enter the Jamaat with a fresh spirit and zeal. When they see the lofty status of the people of the past, then a new spirit of excelling one another is also infused, and the level of piety goes on increasing on a national level. Therefore, when we make the claim that after accepting the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, we would reform our condition and that it would bring about a revolution in the world, then we need to analyze ourselves on a permanent basis. But you will not only need to assess your own condition, you will also have to analyze the condition of your wives and children. The promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam has written that a wife is most aware of her husband's words and deeds and all his secrets. If the man is on the right path, then so too will the woman be. Otherwise, she will reveal his actions to him. That what are you trying to reform me? First reform yourself. Therefore, for the reformation of women, it is necessary that men also bring about pious reformation within themselves. We should always remember that if a woman is reformed, then it guarantees the reformation of the future generations. So, in order to infuse pious reformation in the future generations and to ensure they remain firmly rooted on their religion, then men most of all need to pay attention to their own condition. The example of the men and the women, the father and the mother, of the husband and the wife, it will remind the children to remain on the right path, and that their real objective is not to drown in the world or in materialism. Rather, their real purport is to attain the pleasure of Almighty Allah. Here, I would like to clarify a certain matter, that nobody should assume that, God forbid, the companions of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, had so many weaknesses in them, which is why the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, had to say all of this. As I have said already, there might have been just one or two companions who did not reach the high standard laid down by the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him. However, the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, did not even want to see one or two companions displaying any kind of weakness. In the same gathering in which he referred to his utmost shock by observing the weaknesses of some, he also says that we see that in this Jamaat, it has most visibly progressed in sincerity and devotion, at times witnessing the sincerity, love and zealous faith, I am astonished myself. Hazur says that therefore there were those who displayed passionate faith and they were in fact in the majority. Further, we should say that all of those were those who displayed passionate faith in comparison to us. However, a prophet desires to see his Jamaat at the highest standard of faith, and the era through which we are passing currently, that is our era, there are still numerous prophecies of God yet to be fulfilled. This is the Promised Messiah alayhi salam's era, which we are currently passing through, and the prophecies that Allah the Almighty prophesied to him, many have still to come to pass. So therefore, if we desire to see those promises fulfilled quickly in our lifetimes, then we need to keep a close watch on our sincerity, faith and our taqwa. When we desire from Almighty Allah that He displays the progress of the Jamaat to us, then we also need to strive to attain His pleasure. I should add that in this era, also with the grace of Allah, there are so many people who have immense devotion and sincerity within them and who are passing on this very spirit into the future generations. Once, regarding the Ahmadis of Pakistan, I expressed a concern that after the Lahore tragedies, the Khudam, or perhaps some of the Safedom Ansar, who give duties in Jamaat buildings or mosques. Among them, the report that has emerged is that because of carrying out duties over a long period, they feel exhausted or they have shown indifference. This is why attention needs to be given towards this, or the administration needs to look into this. When the Sadr Khudam Al-Ahmadiyya Pakistan conveyed this to the Khudam of Pakistan, I received many letters from the Khudam of Pakistan which were expressing their sincerity and dedication to the full. They said that we reaffirm our pledge that we were never tired before, and nor will we ever, inshallah, with the grace of Allah, allow such a thought to creep in, that performing duties of the Jamaat could ever be a burden to us. Do not worry, this will never happen, they said. Similarly, letters were sent from women, which said that my brother, my husband, or my son, they return from their work and then go immediately to carry out Jamaat duties, and we happily bid them farewell from the homes. With the grace of Allah, we do not fear at all remaining behind alone. So therefore, this devotion and loyalty, as the Promised Messiah alayhi salam has said, is because of the intensity of faith. You should also remember that whilst carrying out these duties or obligations, never forget your God. Prayers should be offered on time, and during your duties, go on remembering Almighty Allah and also continue praying. The greatest power for us is Almighty Allah. The help and support we will receive will only be received from Allah. Our efforts are just humble and meek, and we are performing these in accordance with God's commands. Whatever is to be done will actually be done by God. Thus, when you attach yourself with God, then He Himself will seek revenge from the enemy and will stop him. So never be slack in prayers. The benefit of the worship and prayers and remembrance of Allah should be practically manifested from the lives of every one of us. Then only can we reach the level expected and desired by the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, says in one place that Allah the Almighty states that Inna Allaha ma'al lazina taqaw wal lazina hum muhsinun. That those who adopt taqwa, purity and sanctity, are supported by Allah, and they are always afraid and anxious of disobeying God's commands. So therefore it is the taqwa and the fear of Allah that protects a person at all times, and which completely delivers one from worldly anxieties. Therefore, if an Ahmadi should hold fear of anything whatsoever, then it should be the fear of Allah the Almighty, that may He not become angered at us. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, peace be upon him, states in one place that Allah the Almighty addressed me and said that I should inform my Jamaat that whoever has believed, such belief that has no attachment with the world whatsoever, and that belief and that faith that is bereft of hypocrisy and cowardice, and such belief in faith that is not devoid of any standard of obedience whatsoever, such people are the beloved of God. And God says that the steps such people take are on the path of truth and sincerity. Therefore, this is a level of belief in faith that the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, peace be upon him, expected from us. May Allah grant us the ability to inculcate such high belief within ourselves. At this time, with reference to obedience, I would like to say a few words. As obedience was just mentioned, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, said that one should not be devoid of any standard of obedience. There are various standards of obedience which we need to keep in mind. There are different ranks of obedience. There is obedience to the Nizam-e-Jamaat, the system of the community. There is obedience to the commands of Allah. This is also a type of obedience. Similarly, a person thinks of many other things. So in order to fully implement the system and to become fully submissive to Almighty Allah, it is obedience alone. That if a person keeps watch over it, then he keeps progressing. There are levels of obedience. For example, we find a high standard of obedience in the history of Jamaat Ahmadiyya. And we find that in Hadrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him, when the telegram was received from the promised Messiah alayhi salam, that come immediately. At the time he was sitting in his clinic. He immediately and quickly left from there. This call did not come from the same city he was in, but even then he just got up as he was. In fact, the promised Messiah alayhi salam was in Delhi, and Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him, was in Qadian. He sent a message to his family at home that I am leaving. He did not feel the need to pack anything, nor the need to arrange expenditure, clothes or luggage or anything at all. He went straight to the station. The train was a little delayed. In that time he met an acquaintance who was quite rich. He wanted to show a patient who was ill to Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him, and he requested him to tend to him. Because the train was late, he was able to look at that ill person. The fees he received for treating that ill patient was sufficient to cover his cost of travel. So this is how Allah provided him with the means. So he then went to his master. When he reached his destination, he came to know that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, had not said that he should come immediately. The person writing the telegram had added the words that he should come immediately. However, he did not complain at all that why was he put through this difficulty or trouble. He remained there most happily. So this is the highest standard of obedience, that every concern and every thought is insignificant in comparison to fulfilling a command. Then, as I have said, Allah responds by providing the means as well. So these are the people who Allah the Almighty says are His favorite, and this is the guiding principle for us. Then there is an Nizam-e-Jamaat, the system of the community, in which one needs to obey the most junior officers all the way up to the Khalifa of the time. In actuality, this is a continuation and the steps up of the obedience to Allah and the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. As the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said, "Whoever obeys my Amir or leader obeys me, and whoever obeys me obeys Allah." Therefore, it is essential to fulfill the basic levels of obedience of the Nizam, of the system, even at the lowest levels. If you look at any community or from a worldly perspective, if you analyze any organization or government in the world, they have a system established. Without this system, the organization cannot run. It is essential for its operation. Governments of the world also have in place rules and regulations to effectively run its system. To abide by these regulations is essential. And because governments have power, they use it to ensure that their system is followed and abided by according to their publicized regulations. However, in a spiritual system, a person abides by the regulations out of sincerity and devotion, and also in order to attain Allah's pleasure. This is why the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, said that one who obeys at every stage are my favorite or my beloved. Therefore, those who obey the Nizam or the system of the community at the lowest to the highest levels do so for the purpose of pleasing Allah. The promise made by Allah to the believers of Khilafat, and the promise in the Holy Quran of the Khilafat, which was to remain established amongst the community of believers. We find only one example of this at this time, and that is currently within the Jamaat Ahmadiyya. However, the verse before this verse, known as Ayat Istikhlaf, in which Allah's promised Khilafat, that is, in the verse before this, Allah the Almighty states that وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهَدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ لَإِنْ أَمْرَتَهُمْ لَيَخْرُجُنَّ قُلْ لَا تُقْسِمُوا طَاعَةٌ مَعْرُوفَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And they swear by Allah their strongest oath, that if you command them, they will surely go forth. Say, swear not. What is required is actual obedience in what is right. Surely Allah is well aware of what you do. So here Allah has referred to the obedience of believers, that how believers demonstrate obedience, because whenever they are provided instructions, they reply Sami'na wa ata'na. They announce that we hear and we obey. Whether the instruction is contrary or in support of our wishes is irrelevant. Our obligation is to obey. So this is the highest level of obedience which should be found within a believer. And Allah the Almighty has stated that if you are truly a believer, then you do not need to take strong oaths. Only obey in accordance to the normal standard in whatever is good. Obey according to the traditions. We do stand up and pledge that whatever maruf decision or good instruction is provided, we would deem it imperative to abide by it. However, when the actual matters comes to hand, we may show reluctance. Thus, Allah the Almighty states that a true believer is he who does not merely take oath. Rather, he obeys in every single circumstance and situation. Here I should clarify, when speaking here and earlier about obedience in good matters and good decisions, that is, maruf decisions, that the Khilafat of Ahmadiyyat never acts or says anything contrary to the commands of Allah. A maruf or good decision means that all matters drawn out by the Sharia will be abided by. If every Ahmadi firmly believes that this sequence of Khilafat is in accordance with Khilafa min Hajj Nabuwa, that is, Khilafat on the precepts of Prophethood, then we would also have to believe firmly that this Khilafat would never provide any instructions contrary to the Sharia. Then there is a Nizam-e-Jamaat, the system of the community. When it runs according to the system of Khilafat, it will never provide any instructions in contradiction to the Sharia. And if it happens to provide any incorrect instructions, then these errors will be rectified by the Khalifa of the time when the matter comes before the Khalifa. Therefore, when an Ahmadi prays for the strengthening or the consolidation of the Khilafat, he should alongside pray that he himself becomes one who demonstrates the highest standards of obedience, so that he remains attached to the blessings of Khilafat and so he can remain the favorite of God. And also so that Allah never deprives him of the guidance that he has currently remained firm on. Therefore, sometimes people express a lack of faith or confidence in the Nizam or the system of the Jamaat out of vested interests, and they subsequently become deprived of that reward and blessing which Allah the Almighty bestowed upon us after 1400 years. For example, it often happens in the matters of the qaza. Because of certain obligations out of the law, the qaza being a system within the Jamaat which acts as an arbitrator or mediator to settle disputes. When people are asked to give a written statement that they would happily abide by the verdict of the qaza and arbitration system without any complaint whatsoever, and that they now enter this system of the qaza and bring forth a case of their own volition. So when this written statement is demanded, so some desist from doing this. And the reason for this rejection is that they spitefully suspect that a verdict will be made against them, and therefore they decide that we will not provide a written agreement. Such people's intentions are irreverent from the outset. They only aim to take some time, that let us delay the case here for a while. If the decision here is not in our favor, then we will take the case to the courts of the government. And when such people reject the qaza decision and go to the outside courts instead, and then they receive a verdict against them even there, they then attempt to return to the Jamaat system of justice, but the Jamaat does not accept this. Because at the first instance they disobeyed. They did not trust the Jamaat administration. And the result is quite evident, that Allah the Almighty says that such people leave the fold of obedience and are those who displease me. When a person becomes displeasing to Allah the Almighty, then even though he may still be an apparent member of the Jamaat, he in reality cannot get any benefit from the beneficence of the Jamaat which Allah the Almighty provides to the members of the Jamaat because of their attachment to it. So although these seem to be petty things, but a person's mistrust and ill thinking leads him to be deprived of Allah's grace and blessings. Therefore, every Ahmadi should strive his utmost to become the favorite of Allah. Because in this lies the sustenance of us and our generations. Alongside this, I would like to say to the office bearers of the Jamaat, that they can only be called the true representatives of Khilafat when they fulfill the requirements of justice with the fear of Allah in their hearts. If anyone drifts away or stumbles due to the mistreatment of any office holder, then he would be responsible for that, because he has not discharged full justice on the trust upon him. If a person stumbles or drifts away due to that office bearer's mistake, and he does it on purpose, then most certainly he is responsible and he has not fulfilled his trust. So therefore, every Ahmadi, whichever position he may be in, that he should understand that in order to fulfill the covenant of Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance, and to keep his faith intact, he would have to stick to truthfulness and piety in every circumstance, so that the purpose of the advent of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, can be fulfilled. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, says in one place that I am not satisfied with just large numbers in the community. Hazrat says that just a large size of the Jamaat is not a cause of joy. So he continues that the real meaning of a Jamaat is not that people just place their hands upon one another and pledge allegiance. They can only be entitled to be called a Jamaat when they abide by the conditions of the Bayt, when they truly inculcate a pious reformation within themselves and their life is completely free from sin and filth, when they efface their personal desires and come out of the grip of Satan and immerse themselves in the pleasure of Allah, when they discharge Haqqullah and Haqqul Abad, the rights of Allah and His people, in a complete and perfect manner, and when there is a passionate desire to propagate their religion in them, and when they completely destroy their selfish egos and desires and become devoted to God instead. So he says further that righteous people are those who fear God and efface those things which are against the will of Almighty Allah. They consider the selfish desire, egos and things of the world insignificant compared to Almighty Allah. May Allah the Almighty grant all of us the ability to lead our lives according to the wishes of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him.
Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu. ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ